Okay, Sukrut, you can start. Let's
Okay,
start.
sorry. So the title of this talk is Hydrodynamic Attractor in a Toy Model of Coagulon Plasma. It is based on this recent paper. So the outline of the talk is as follows. So first, I will try to introduce the concept of hydrodynamic attractors. Then I will describe the hydrodynamic attractor in a simple setup of heavy ion collisions. Then I will talk about this hybrid two-fluid model, which is a toy model of coagulon plasma. And finally, I will describe the results of a recent paper. So let's start. So this plot shows the schematic of evolution of matter produced in heavy ion collisions. So heavy ion collision, in heavy ion collisions, two heavy nuclei like lead or gold collide with each other at very high velocities, ultra-relativistic velocities. And this collision produces very high energy densities. At such high energy densities, the quarks and gluons within the hadrons deconfine, and they exist in a state, deconfined state called coagulon plasma. So which eventually expands and cools down to form hadrons, and they are detected in the detectors. So these nuclei, since they are moving at ultra-relativistic speed, they are in the frame of the collider, they look like these pancakes. So this QGP, coagulon plasma, is the hottest and the smallest fluid on Earth. Its specific viscosity is smaller than any known superfluid. So in that sense, it's the most perfect fluid on Earth. Also, QGP was present in the microsecond old universe after the Big Bang. Thus, understanding this state of matter would help us understand, would help us probe into such early stage in the after in the universe after the Big Bang. So, why is QGP a fluid? So, the most of the particles detected in the heavy ion collisions have low values of PT. PT stands for transverse momentum. These low PT particles show the signs of collective behavior as well known from the experimental measurements. Further, the hydrodynamic, thus we know that the state of matter formed in between much relativity. Also, the hydrodynamic simulations of this QGP successfully reproduce the experimental data of heavy ion collisions for these low PT particles. Now, this can be illustrated with this plot. So on vertical axis, these VNs are called flow coefficients, which are the experimental observables that essentially measure the correlations between the particles that are detected as a function of the transverse momentum. Now, these black dots are the data from the heavy ion collision experiments, and the different colored bands are the results of hydrodynamic simulation. So, as the plot shows, for the PT less than 1 GeV, there is a good agreement between the hydrodynamic simulations and the experimental data. So, hydrodynamics describes any minimum system at macroscopic level when there is a large separation of scale in the system. So, this separation of scale is quantified by this Km called as Knudsen number, which is the ratio of microscopic length scale to the macroscopic length scale. So, for example, if the microscopic description of the system is described by a kinetic theory, then this small l micro would be the mean free path of particles. Now, hydrodynamic EM tensor, electromagnetic tensor, has this form, where the first two terms form the perfect fluid component, whereas and on top of it, we have viscous corrections, where this epsilon is the energy density, P is the pressure, U is the velocity of energy flow, and G minus is the background metric. So this requirement that Knudsen number should be very smaller than one is same as requiring these viscous corrections on top of the perfect fluid part to be small compared to the perfect fluid part. when the system is in equilibrium in the less frame of the fluid, this energy momentum tensor takes this diagonal form, which is isotropic. So any anisotropies would be essentially due to these viscous corrections in this G mu nu.
So G mu nu is now what, Minkowski, for this second formula?
For second formula. So the typical hydrodynamic simulations that match with the experimental data in heavy ion collisions, they start at very early times after the collision, at which the anisotropies in the systems are still very large. So this time scale is roughly about 0.5 Fermis per C after the collision. So this plot shows the distribution of energy density in the transverse plane at this time scale. So these different colors show the magnitude of the energy density. So as is clear from the plot, the distribution is highly anisotropic. So this is quite puzzling because the hydrodynamic still describes the system well beyond in the region where it is not supposed to describe it well. So the first answer to this puzzle was given by a calculation in ADS CFT. So this can be illustrated by using this plot. So on the vertical axis, we have this variable A, which essentially measures the anisotropy in the system, where this delta P is the difference between the transverse and longitudinal pressures, whereas P is the pressure in the equilibrium. And this W is the dimensionless time, the time measured in the units of local temperature.
What is transverse pressure?
The pressure in the direction
perpendicular to the collision axis.
No. So we have longitudinal direction defined by the collision axis. So the two directions perpendicular to the collision axis would be termed as transverse. So delta P would be difference between this pressure in the transverse plane minus the pressure in the along the collision axis.
Thank you.
So these gray lines, these are the calculations done in the N equal 4 Super Young Mills theory using holography. Now this N equal 2 Super Young Mills is a cousin theory of QCD. Whereas these different colored dotted lines, they are the first, second, and third order hydrodynamic solutions. So, and this calculation was done in a simple heavy ion collision like setup called Bjorken flow, which I will describe later. So, as is clear from the plot, the calculations done in N equal 4 Super Young Mills match quite well with the hydrodynamic curves at time scales when corresponding anisotropies are quite large, like 0.75. So which means that the viscous corrections are almost the same magnitude as the perfect weight part. So another thing is the local thermalization the equilibration would essentially mean that there is no anisotropy, as I showed before. Like at equilibrium, the T mu nu will be isotropic. So that will be when this A becomes zero. And we can kind of extrapolate from this plot that the time scale for that will be very large as compared to this hydrodynamization time scale. So what I mean by hydrodynamization is that the system will be described, the evolution of energy momentum tensor and also the conserved current would be described by the first or second order hydrodynamics. And as we saw, the hydrodynamization is quite different from local thermalization or equilibration. So this concept of hydrodynamization was shown to be a more general phenomenon by the existence of hydrodynamic attractors in this 2015 paper by Heller and Spelinski. And later, the hydrodynamic attractors have also been found in many other phenomenological approaches. So now I will describe these hydrodynamic attractors. So let's start I'll start by briefly introducing this relativistic hydrodynamics properly. So in hydrodynamics, we have the degrees of freedom given by local energy density and local flow velocity, U mu, which is a time-like vector. The energy momentum tensor, which I showed before, is a function of these energy density, flow velocity, and gradients of these two. Now, the pressure will be a function of energy density given by the equation of state. And this is called a constitutive relation. Further, the equations of hydrodynamics are just the conservation equations of energy momentum tensor. So the energy momentum tensor of hydrodynamics can be decomposed into two parts. The T minus zero is the perfect fluid part, and this phi minus is the dissipative part, so which contains the viscous corrections. Now, this phi minus contains the gradients of U mu different orders. So at first order, it will correspond to first order gradients of mu mu. At second order, all possible terms, the second order gradients of mu mu. So at first order, there are two possible terms, and they come with the corresponding coefficients. These are called transport coefficients. So this eta and zeta. So eta is called the shear viscosity, and zeta is called the bulk viscosity. So the first order hydrodynamics is also called as Navier-Stokes hydrodynamics. Now, these equations of motion for Navier-Stokes hydrodynamics are not hyperbolic PDEs, and they do not have well-posed initial value problem. And the linear perturbations about the equilibrium solutions in the Stokes propagate faster than speed of light. So these kind of problems are overcome in this MIS formulation of hydrodynamics. So in MIS theory, this pi mu nu is promoted to an independent dynamical variable, which satisfies another equation. So I will restrict only to the, for simplicity, I will only restrict to the case of conformal fluids. For which bulk viscosity is zero, thus Navier-Stokes pi mu nu at first order will be just given at minus eta sigma mu nu. Now, in MIS theory, this constitutive relation is essentially modified by adding an extra term which contains a gradient of this pi mu nu, and it comes with another transport coefficient, tau pi. So this will be another independent equation apart from the usual conservation equations, del mu t mu nu equal to zero. So if we substitute the first order Navier-Stokes constitutive relation on this, in this pi mu nu, in this expression on right hand side, so we'll get a second order constitutive relation for the left hand side pi mu nu, and then we can do this order by order, in the sense we can again substitute the second order pi mu nu on the right hand side, and we can get the third order pi mu nu on left side. So in this sense, the MIS is a resummation of hydrodynamics to all orders, and which means that it contains more degrees of freedom than just in Navier-Stokes equation, which are essentially come due to this pi mu nu. So the speed of sound in MIS theory is given by this expression, where eta is the shear viscosity, tau pi is the relaxation time, which was introduced in this expression. These are transport coefficient, S is the entropy density. Now this V is always less than one as long as this inequality is satisfied by the transport coefficients. And all the known microscopic theories satisfy these inequalities. So as shown in this 2015 paper by Heller and Spelinski, the hydrodynamic attractor emerges in such a simple model, such a simple theory, MIS theory, in a setup called Bjorken flow setup, which I will describe in the next slide. So what is meant by hydrodynamic attractor is that there exists a unique curve called hydrodynamic attractor curve, to which all the non-equilibrium states in the theory evolve. And also the truncated hydrodynamics also evolves to this curve. Further, this attractor curve is well defined even when the hydrodynamic gradient expansion itself diverges. So the Bjorken flow is a one-dimensional model of heavy ion collisions. In this model, the incoming colliding nuclei, which are essentially pancakes due to Lorentz contraction, are modeled as infinite sheets in the transverse plane, transverse to the collision axis. And thus, all the dynamics only happens along the longitudinal direction, that is along the direction of collision axis. This assumption is phenomenologically viable because the Lorentz contraction factors at the heavy ion collision experiments like Rieck and LSC are very large, like 100 and 2500. Further, there is assumption of boost invariance in this longitudinal direction in this model. So and space time rapidity I are natural to this all variables in these coordinates become functions only of proper time tau, which is Lorentz scalar. The Minkowski metric can be written in the coordinates as this. Further, the divergence of flow velocity u mu is just 1 by tau in these coordinates. The hydrodynamic gradient expansion, which is expansion gradients of u mu, becomes a series essentially in one powers of 1 by tau in this simple setup. Now, since we are working with thermal fluid, we'll use conformal equation of state given by epsilon equal to 3p. So the equation of state is an input to the hydrodynamics from the underlying microscopic theory. And also the transport coefficients, the eta and tau pi, they are also the input to hydrodynamics from the underlying microscopic theory. So now in this simple setup, the pi menu takes this very simple form, and thus it has only one independent variable, this is phi, and thus phi essentially measures the anisotropy of the system. Now we can parameterize, we can work with the parameterization, dimensionless parameterizations. So we can work with this dimensionless time variable W and this dimensionless anisotropy variable F defined this way. Now this F defined in this way can also be shown to be equal proportional to this anisotropy variable phi, and F is dimensionless. So F will be a dimensionless anisotropy variable. Now, does the hydrodynamic series will be just a series in powers of 1 by W because in this W dimensionless time. Now, the equations of motion for the MIS theory in this simple setup just value down to one non-trivial equation as F in, as a function of W, a first order differential equation where this thetas and thetas are the dimensionless parameters which contain the transport coefficients. Now, all the sense, this equation, which are at an initial state, different initial conditions to this equation as a function of W, evolved to one unique attractor curve. Shown by this magenta curve, where these blue lines are the different initial conditions. So this is a plot of A as a function of W. And these red and green dotted lines are the first and second order hydrodynamic evolutions. They also converge to this magenta curve, which is a hydrodynamic attractor curve. Now this curve can be obtained as follows. So at early times, W equal to zero, if we substitute in this equation, so we only get a quadratic equation in F. The derivative term will go away because it is proportional to W. So it has two solutions. One of the solution is a dispersal, meaning that different initial conditions starting near that solution diverge, and the other solution is where all the different initial conditions converge. Now, in summary, MI contains the Dijkstra equation satisfied by mu and Navier-Stokes. All these extra non-hydrodynamic degrees of freedom decay eventually, and the initial conditions evolve to a unique hydrodynamic attractor curve. Now this hydrodynamic attractor curve is well defined even at early times where the hydrodynamic gradients would be large, because in this setup, as I explained before, the hydrodynamic gradient series is essentially a series in powers of 1 over time, 1 over W. So at early times, these terms will be very large, which are proportional, which are powers of 1 over W. But hydrodynamic attractor is well defined at all times. Thus, now this concept of hydrodynamization that I introduced in the introduction, that can be thought as an approach of a system towards a hydrodynamic attractor. In this paper again, Bahar and Spalisky, they showed that in this setup, the hydrodynamic gradient series sum to all orders actually diverges. It has zero radius of convergence. But as we saw, the hydrodynamic attractor is well defined at all times. So thus perhaps the existence of hydrodynamic attractor can be thought of as the definition of hydrodynamics. It was also shown in this paper that this f as a function of W can be given by trans-series expansion, which has a finite radius of convergence. But I won't go into details of this as it is not required for this talk. Now this plot is to show that a strongly coupled system reaches hydrodynamic attractor faster than a weakly coupled system. So the left plot is for the strongly coupled system and right for the weakly coupled system. For the strongly coupled system, the transport coefficients are given by n equal 4 super Youngmin's values, whereas for the weakly coupled system, they are given by the 3 times higher specific viscosity. Now, these hydrodynamic attractors have also been found in many other theories. This slide shows 3 of such attractors in 3 different theories. So first, RBRST is an extended version of MIS. The middle one is the kinetic theory, and the right one is the n equal 4 calculation using ADS-CFT, as in the complete calculation in the microscopic theory. So these are different gray lines in each plot are the different initial conditions, and the black solid line is the hydrodynamic attractor. So as we see, all the initial conditions eventually converge to hydrodynamic attractor. Now, the hydrodynamic attractors have also been found in non-conformal theories and also in setups other than Bjorken flow. So thus this existence of attractor is not just due to definition of conformality and Bjorken flow. So now in the next part, I will describe this hybrid fluid model, which is a model for a system having hybrid degrees of freedom, so which I will describe in detail now. So as we know, QCD, which is a theory of strong force, has a running coupling, which means that the coupling alpha s is a function of energy scale mu, and alpha s decreases with increase in energy scale. So at high energies, QCD is weakly coupled, and at low energies, QCD is strongly coupled. Only in the weakly coupled case, the QCD can be described using perturbative techniques. But when alpha s is very large at small energies, we have to use non-perturbative methods. Now the matter produced in Hevian collisions from its production till the hadrons are detected in the detector. Throughout this evolution, it involves wide range of energy scales. Most of the stages of this evolution involve weakly interacting as well as strongly interacting degrees of freedom simultaneously, and their roles cannot be factorized. For example, the phenomenology of high PT particles can be well understood using perturbation theory. Whereas, as we saw in the beginning, the low PT hadrons fit well to hydrodynamic models, and the microscopic description at low energy scale can be given using non-perturbative approaches. Whereas the phenomenology of the intermediate PT hadrons is not well understood. So one can ask whether it is possible to have effective description, which combines both perturbative as well as non-perturbative degrees of freedom consistently in one framework. So this can be done using this approach called semi-holography, which combines both perturbative and non-perturbative degrees sectors consistently in one framework. So this approach was introduced in these papers and developed later on in all these papers. So according to Wilsonian approach to renormalization group, we know that non-perturbative dynamics at a given energy scale only depends on the perturbative dynamics only up to that scale. So in this semi-holographic framework, we would like to obtain the effective macroscopic description of the combined system from the coarse grain descriptions of the subsectors. Now, this indeed can be achieved in this framework using a class of couplings called as democratic couplings. These democratic couplings can be of different types, like scalar coupling, a vector coupling, and so on. Since we are interested in the coupling of two fluid descriptions, two fluid life sectors, so and for this thing, the metric couplings are relevant, which I will describe in the next slide. So the essential idea behind this democratic coupling is that the full theory, the physical theory, or the physical system lives in the some actual metric background. Let's denote it here by G mu B. And this physical system living in this actual background is assumed to be made up of two hypothetical systems, each living in its own effective metric background. So to explain this better, I am using the color codes here. So all the blue colored quantities correspond to first subsystem, and all the red color quantities correspond to second subsystem. So these metric couplings work by making effective metric of each subsector a functional of the energy momentum tensor of the complement sector. Thus, this G mu, which is effective metric for the first subsystem, is a functional of this T tilde gamma delta, which is energy momentum tensor of the second subsystem, and vice versa. Now, also these subsystems are closed with respect to their own effective matrix, which means that their energy momentum tensors are conserved with respect to their own effective matrix. Thus, we have these two Ward entities for each subsector, where this delta mu is the covariant derivative with respect to metric G mu nu, and delta mu tilde is the covariant derivative with respect to metric G mu tilde. Now, the explicit form of these coupling equations is this. So, this gamma and gamma prime, these are the initial holographic couplings introduced by this framework. Then notice that in the second and the third terms, the coupling, the contraction of indices work differently. Both the systems are treated symmetrically or democratically using these equations, because these coupling equations are symmetric with respect to both the systems. Now, the energy momentum tensor for the full system, the physical system, which lives in the actual background metric G mu B, it can be constructed from the individual subsystem energy momentum tensors, and it is given by this expression. Now, this EM full system EM tensor is guaranteed to be conserved in the actual background metric, just given the individual Ward entities and the coupling equations. So in that sense, this is a consistent framework. Now, further, this notice that this full system T mu nu is just a polynomial of the subsystem energy momentum tensors, this small T mu nu's and small T mu nu tildes. So if the subsystems are described by the fluids, so this small t minus and small t minus tildes are the fluid energy momentum tensors. Then in order to be able to describe this full system t minus, we want this expression to only contain the operators which can be described with using hydrodynamics, or rather the operators of the subsystems which can be described using with the framework of hydrodynamics of the two sectors. And this kind of couplings, the demo comes in, ensure that this does happen, which wouldn't be the case in general. So that's what I just explained. So this hybrid two fluid model, the each subsystem would be described by a fluid living in its own effective metric background. Now, from now on, we set this physical metric background of the full system, G minu B, to be just a flat Minkowski system. Now, the equilibrium of this hybrid two fluid system, was studied in this paper by coupling two perfect fluids. So in equilibrium, the answers for the effective matrix G minu and G minu tilde will be given by these diagonal matrix, where these A, B, A tilde and B tilde are just constants since we are in equilibrium. Then the EM tensors, the two perfect fluids, are given by this in this framework, these expressions. The coupling equations take this form. Now the important thing is the full EM tensor takes the perfect fluid form, which I showed how to construct before. So, and this full system energy density and the pressures can be constructed by these expressions in term using the variables of the subsystems. Now, this kind of construction has been shown to be consistent with dynamics. So, I will try to explain this. So we can define the temperatures of the full system, this mathcal T, T1 and T2 for the first and second subsystem, as the inverse length of the thermal circle in their respective metric backgrounds, where this tau would be just weak rotated time. Now, in this in case of two fluids in equilibrium, these G0, these factors are essentially the 0-0 component of the matrix, which essentially is A and A tilde. So we'll get essentially A tilde here and T and T2. And we show the, and from this, essentially we'll get that this relation, the full system temperature, mathcal T is equal to T1A, equal to T2A. Just a full system energy, a full system temperature parameter, the global equilibrium of the full system. Now, full system temperature can also be defined independently using the system. And the T obtained in this manner agrees with this earlier definition of the T defined in this way. Further, system entropy density can also be obtained like this. Now, as I mentioned before, each subsystem is closed with respect to its own background metric, as in its energy momentum tensor of each system is conserved in its own background metric. So, in general, for a system consisting of two closed systems, we would expect that the total entropy to be just the sum of the individual entropies. However, the two systems do interact through the metric couplings. So thus the full system entropy density is the sum of the subsystem entropy densities up to these V cube and B tilde cube factors. These V cube and B tilde cube factors are essentially the volume factors like this. So we know that the invariant measure is given by d3x square root of minus g in a particular metric G minu.
So here you mean only the spatial volume factor, right? It's not square root minus
spatial.
This is spatial, the minus square root minus g.
Because b only appears in the spatial part, a will appear in the temporal part. Yeah, so it can also be shown that the divergence of this entropy current constructed like this is always positive. In other words, entropy current always is always non-negative, as is required by the thermodynamics.
So, Krut, one thing is that your voice is sometimes...
Hello? Actually, your screen is frozen. I think I will continue. Okay, so come to the last part of the talk. And I will describe the results of our paper, find that this is a hydrogen tracker in the liquid fluid model. So essentially, in the previous paper, this model was studied only in the equilibrium. So we have extended this model to capture the full non-equilibrium dynamics of the system, of the hybrid system, by describing subsector by MIS theory. We work in this Bjorken flow setup, thus the full metric background, which is still the flat Minkowski background, will be given in terms of Milne coordinates like this. Then we make the boost invariance ansatz for the effective matrix of subvectors given by these two expressions, where all these elements of this effective matrix are functions of only the proper time tau, the Lorentz scalar. We'll again work with the conformal equations of state for both the subsystems. The energy momentum tensor of the each subsystem will be given by these expressions, where the first will be again the perfect fluid part, and this phi mu will contain the viscous corrections, again given by just one independent component in each case for each phi mu. And we'll have similar equations of motion, the conservation equation and MIS equation, now for each subsector. We'll work with the following parameterization for transport coefficient, just like before, where this C eta and C tau are the dimensionless parameters, and similarly tilde ones for the other system. They contain the transport coefficients. Now, for the strictly coupled system, choose the values of the transport coefficients given by these C tau and C eta, as this 2 minus log 2 by 2 pi and 1 by 4 pi. Whereas for the weakly coupled system, choose the tending specificity, which that is theta, as compared to the strongly coupled system. And we choose the C tau and theta relation, the weakly coupled system as C equals 5 theta, which is also the case for the RT kinetic theory. Now the causality requirement here is that this ratio square root sigma C eta by C tau should be less than 1 by root 2. Less than 1 by root 2. Now for the weakly coupled system, these choices of matrix have sigma 0.4 and for the strongly coupled system 0.62. And we have sigma tilde greater than sigma. From now on, as a convention, I will denote the tilde system as strongly coupled and the other one non-tilde as a weakly coupled. Now, in this case, we'll get six non-trivial equations from coupling metric coupling equations, and we can solve them for metric coefficients. So if you can recall, so this matrix has effective matrix coefficients A, B, C, and tildes, and we get the six coupling equations, which are algebraic equations. So we can solve for them. Then we are left only four variables: energy densities and the anisotropies of each subsystem. Now there are four more non-trivial equations that come from the equations of motion. These are the first-order differential equations. So we'll have, so basically we have four equations and four variables. And these are first order differential equations. So we have a four dimensional phase space spanned by these four variables, epsilon, phi, and their two tilde variables. Now, a two dimensional hydrodynamic attractor surface exists in this four dimensional phase space, which I will explain. So we'll work with these dimensional and isotropic variables, chi, defined in this way. Now, what we can do is we can give some initial conditions for these four variables, epsilon phi, epsilon tilde, phi tilde, at some initial time, say tau equal to 1. And then we will evolve the system backwards in time. Now, what we find that for generic initial conditions for these four variables, the solution either diverge as you go backward in time, or they go to a dispersor, which will be a constant negative value, as in case of the MIS attractor that I described earlier. So only by tuning two of the four variables, the initial values of two of the four variables, we can find that these chi's will go to some constant values at initial time. And these constant values are given by this sigma, chi to this sigma, and chi tilde will go to this sigma tilde for this specific solution, which are obtained by tuning two of the four initial conditions. So this can be explained better by this plot. So on the vertical axis, we have the chi, and on horizontal axis, we have the time tau in dimension is gamma power minus 1/4, where this gamma is just the semi-holographic coupling. So this whole thing is dimensionless. So we start at tau equal to 1 with some initial conditions. Now these are tuned in initial conditions such that at early times, the system goes to this constant sigma values, sigma and sigma tilde. So this blue curve is for the strongly coupled system, and the red curve is for the weakly coupled system. And these horizontal lines, the violet one is the sigma tilde value 0.62, and the orange one is the sigma value 0.45. So this is the dispersal solution. This is only for one of the stars. Start tau equal to 1 and go to this some negative value for this blue curve, whereas this violet curve is just the constant sigma tilde value that we had here. Yeah, so this plot depicts this better. So these thick lines are the attractor solutions, whereas these thin lines are the neighboring trajectories that eventually converge to these attractor solutions. The blue is for the strongly coupled system, orange for the weakly coupled system, whereas the red for the total system. Now, there is one feature of this model is that the energy densities in the weakly coupled system is always greater than the energy density in the strongly coupled system at early times. This can be also seen analytically as follows.
Sukrut?
Yeah.
Sukrut, you mean it? This is true only on the attractor, right? Not on the attractor surface, not really.
Yes. Only on that. Yeah, so for the attractor solution, the energy in the weakly coupled sector is always greater than the energy in the strongly coupled sector. So this can be shown, this can be seen analytically as well. So near tau equal to 0, these energy densities have the following tau dependences, where epsilon 1 is for the energy density of weak system and epsilon 2 is the energy density of small system. Now we can take the ratio of the two, epsilon 2 by epsilon 1. So it is given by this. Now, since we have sigma tilde greater than sigma, this exponent is positive and near tau goes to 0, this ratio goes to 0. In other words, epsilon 1, which is the energy density of weak system, always dominates over the energy density of small system. And as the system evolves, the weakly coupled sector transfers its energy to the strongly coupled sector. This is a plot of energy densities as a function of this dimensionless time. The orange sector, orange curve, is for the is represents a weakly coupled sector, and the blue represents a strongly coupled sector. So this is these curves correspond to one particular attractor solution. So as we see at initial time, the weakly coupled system has larger energy than in the strongly coupled system, and which it eventually transfers to the strongly coupled system as the system evolves. Now, the early stages of a real heavy ion collision are well described within the perturbative QCD. By early stages, I mean before the hydrodynamics starts applicable, so the very early stages after the collision. So they can be well described within the framework of perturbative QCD by this so-called bottom of thermalization. So the essential idea is that according to bottom thermalization, initially the system consists of only the hard gluons, and as the system evolves, a bath of soft gluons develops very quickly due to the transfer of energy from the gluons. In other words, the gluon represents the weakly coupled sector because of high energies dominant at the early times, and they transfer over the strongly coupled sector represented by, say, this bath of soft gluons. And the weakly coupled sector transfers energy to the soft sector as the time evolves. Now, so this feature of the bottom thermal line reproduced in this simple two fluid model. Now, if you want to match our model to a more microscopic description at very early times, then we can match it to a microscopic description having the this bottom feature, which the actual QCD does. This is just a plot of the interaction measure as a function of time. By interaction measure, I mean this delta epsilon by epsilon, where delta epsilon is the interaction energy in the system and epsilon is the total energy. So at late times, it becomes very small. So the systems effectively decouple. So we can also obtain the hydrodynamic expansion of the system at late times, where it can be described by these first or second order hydrodynamics. So we had these four variables, epsilon, phi, so where chi is essentially proportional to phi. So we can derive the gradient expansion for these epsilon chi's and system variables in terms of this, in terms of powers of this dimensionless time, omega, defined in this way. So recall that in this Bjorken flow setup, the hydrodynamic gradient expansion essentially expansion powers of this dimensionless time. Now this epsilon pf means a perfect fluid part of the energy density, which can easily be obtained by matching the density of the system to perfect fluid energy density expression at late times when it is described by this perfect fluid. So similarly, we can obtain this epsilon tilde pf similarly. Now this notice that these gradient expansion are given in terms of these variables alpha and beta, which are dimensionless variables, and these alpha and beta essentially characterize the curves on the attractor surface. So we can also obtain a hydrodynamic expansion for this full system energy density is maps in terms of a corresponding dimensionless time variable. And this expression, by comparing it to the system expressions for the energy densities, we can read out this specific viscosity, C eta EFF, for the full system, which reads like this. So these alpha beta, these dimensionless parameters characterize the different curves on the attractor surface. Further, one can do the linear fluctuation analysis about the late time hydro solutions, and from that one can obtain the fluctuations in the hydro solution for these anisotropy variable phis. So delta phi for first system and delta phi tilde for the second system. So these are just normalized by these epsilon PFs to make it dimensionless. Now these forms of the expression hold if this condition is satisfied, that is C tau tilde square root beta is not equal to C tau square root alpha. Now this means that we can have two possibilities, that either the first inequality as shown here or the second inequality. So from these forms of the from these expressions, it can be easily worked out that when the first inequality holds, the delta phi tilde, the fluctuation corresponding to strong sector, will decay faster. And when the second inequality holds, the fluctuation correspond in the weak sector will decay faster. Now, these inequalities just come from the linear fluctuation analysis, but they have also been verified numerically. So the delta phi tilde decays faster means that the phi tilde, the strong system, hydrodynamizes faster. And delta phi decays faster would mean that the phi, that is the phi for weak system, essentially decay faster means the weak system will hydrodynamize faster. So we find that for...
Sorry to interrupt. I just want to make a clarifying comment that the C1 tilde is related to C1, right? So if one of the one? C1 tilde... So it means that... So it means that if the other coefficient is small, then delta phi tilde will decay slower because there's an extra factor of w to the power minus 3 there, right? So so this delta phi tilde will then decay faster if the other coefficient is smaller. No, so I think that is what you wanted to say. The main point also here also is to stress that C2 tilde is related to C2 and C1 tilde is related to C1. C1 and C2 are independent.
I forgot that. What we find that for typical energy densities in the system, only the first equality holds. Like for typical energy densities in the system, the first equality holds and not the second one. Only for very extreme energy densities in the system, like for example, at initial time, if we have, say, the weak system having the 10,000 times more energy density than the strong coupled system, only in such extreme cases, we get this second sort of inequality. For any physical kind of initial conditions, the first equality always holds. In other words, the strongly coupled system sonic coupled sector decays faster than the weakly coupled sector.
Sorry, Sukrut, what do you mean by initial time here?
Okay. So the time at which we start the simulations, I would say. Actually, we consider that time to be given by this semi-holographic coupling, the scale defined by this natural coupling in this model, which is this gamma, semi-holographic coupling. So we have gamma power minus 1 by 4 as gamma power 1 by 4 has a dimension of time, tau. So essentially gamma's like some power of gamma 1 by 4 define a time scale. So we basically start at this time scale, start the system at this time scale. So what I meant was the energy density at this time scale given by this semi-holographic coupling gamma, the time scale defined by the semi-holographic coupling gamma. So we can compare this to the saturation scale in this Glasma effective field theory of the early time dynamics of QGP. So at which we would like to kind of match this two fluid model to some more microscopic model. So that's what I was saying. Yeah, so as I said, for typical kind of energy, initial energy densities, the strongly coupled sector will decay faster than the weakly coupled sector. And this ratio of these, however, the ratio of the hydroanimation times for the two sectors, that does depend on the total amount of energy density in the system at this saturation time, which I just described, given by the scale set by this coupling, semi-holographic coupling gamma. So this ratio we find so good, that...
Why are you calling it saturation time?
So we would like to compare it to this saturation scale QS.
Nothing to do with, there is no time called saturation time, I think. It's just, you mean okay. That this time scale set by the saturation scale, perhaps.
Yeah, that is right. So this ratio, we find that varies from 1.4 to 18. And the ratios of the ratio is larger if the total energy density in the system at this reference time scale is smaller. So this can be kind of better understood by looking at this table. So this table, it comes from the values by setting this gamma, the semi-holographic scale, to 1. So the first three columns describe the total energy density, energy density in the total system, then in the weak system and in the strong system, and this reference time tau 0, given in the units of gamma. Then next two columns are the hydrodynamization times for the weak and the strong system. And the last column is the ratio of these two hydrodynamization time. So the TH weak divided by TH strong. So at when the energy density is large, 0.64, then we see that the weak system and the strong system hydrodynamization times are not very different. So the ratio is 1.4. However, this ratio increases as we decrease the total amount of energy density in the system, and becomes very large for this very low value of energy density, 0.1. So at this value, the weak system takes very large time to hydrodynamize, of 26. So if one wants to compare this to real heavy ion collisions, so this is much greater than the time scale for the freeze out, that is time scale when the system eventually, that the QGP freezes out into hadrons. Thus weak system may never have the time, enough time to hydrodynamize if it kind of hydrodynamizes at such large time scales. So essentially decreasing the energy density in the total system at reference time basically increases the hydrodynamization time for weak system, and it decreases the hydrodynamization time for strong system as compared to what they would have if there was no semi-holographic coupling between the two. Yeah, so I'm done. So in summary, we saw that this hybrid two-fluid model in combination with these MIS equations provides a model for non-equilibrium dynamics of a two-component system with different amounts of couplings, self-couplings. Now this hybrid system exhibits a two-dimensional attractor surface in four-dimensional phase space. The full system behaves as a single fluid at late times, given by the and whose effective shear viscosity can be determined in terms of the two dimensionless parameters that characterize the attractor surface of the hybrid system. This two fluid model reproduces a feature of bottom thermalization in heavy ion collisions, namely that at early times the weak sector dominates over the strong sector, and the weak sector transfers its energy to the strong sector as the system evolves. The ratio and times of the two sectors depend significantly on the total amount of energy density in the system. Yeah, so as an outlook, so in this paper, earlier paper, where the equilibrium of the two fluid model was studied, so it was shown that this hybrid full system exhibit a phase transition from a conformality at small temperatures to an emergent conformality at very large temperatures. Now this transition is either a crossover, a first order or a second order, depending on the value of this small r. This dimensionless semi-holographic coupling constructed from these two dimensionful couplings, gamma prime and gamma, in this way. So far we have only studied the non-equilibrium case for the value of r corresponding to the crossover. Thus we can study, so we can study this non-equilibrium evolution in the case of first or second order phase transitions. Further, we can also study the fluctuations in the system near the phase transition, as the fluctuations become important near the phase transition using frameworks such as stochastic hydrodynamics. So on the attractor of the system. Now another possibilities are that we can relax the assumption of conformality. Also we can add the finite chemical potential. There's one more thing one can do, is that one can work with more microscopic models, such as coupling a kinetic theory and a black hole in place of the mass, study the attractor in such a microscopic model. Yeah.
Okay, Sukrut, thanks for finishing on time, and thanks for your talk. So we should now have sufficient time for taking questions. So please ask questions. Unmuting yourself. So no questions. This is the first time then we are having such a situation of an extremely clear talk that there is no question.
I thought I had troubled him enough in his research proposal. So I
didn't. In his research proposal seminar.
I troubled him already once.
but you can travel him again. No. Because now it will be on record.
Yeah.
Okay. So let's... Okay, in that case, if there are no further questions, let us thank Sukrut, and thanks for being here. And see you next week. And it will be again a talk on the landscape, but it will be more focused on why it is difficult to construct De Sitter solutions in string theory. The speaker will be Keshav Dasgupta from Montreal. So see you next week, and bye, everybody.